Margaret Readdy, she'll be talking about toric arrangements.
Thank you for the introduction. So before talking about arrangements, hyperplane arrangements on the n-dimensional torus, what I'm going to begin talking about is arrangements in Euclidean space and also flag vector questions. So let's actually start with a hyperplane arrangement, H. So we'll consider an arrangement in three-dimensional space. So I'm going to have four hyperplanes. Yeah, only hyperplanes for today. Hope that's acceptable. No complications today.
Well,
maybe. Who knows?
Yeah, hyperplane is
sufficiently complicated.
Okay.
You
perhaps you may. This is a famous hyperplane arrangement. It started at Cornell. They think it's a University of Kentucky arrangement, and it is not. It is a Cornell arrangement. So this is a hyperplane arrangement. So associated with the hyperplane arrangement is an intersection lattice, so L. So what we're going to do is look at all possible intersections of this arrangement, and we're going to order by reverse inclusion. So let's actually, on the bottom, so we're going to form a poset. So if you're not familiar with a poset, which is a partially ordered set, you're going to see lots of examples today. So at the bottom of this poset is going to be the entire space R3. Then we have the four hyperplanes. I'm not labeling anything, so I'm being bad. So sorry. And then you can see these three hyperplanes standing up. They intersect in a unique line. So we have this. And then if you look at each of these hyperplanes that are standing up with the horizontal hyperplane, that intersection is a unique line. So we have three such lines occurring. So we have these pairwise intersections. And finally, this is a central arrangement, meaning that everything passes through the origin. So we actually have the intersection of all the hyperplanes is uniquely determined. It's zero space. So here we have the intersection lattice. So associated with the intersection lattice is something called the characteristic polynomial. So chi of the arrangement. So what this is, we're going to be summing over elements in the lattice. We're going to have a certain coefficient, which I'll explain in a moment, times t to the dimension of whatever subspace we're looking at. So here, this is the Mobius function. So this is an extension of the number theoretic Mobius function. So
what does the number live? Mu of what?
Oh, so you know in number theory, when, I don't know if you studied the Mobius function, and when you look at the Mobius function of an integer, you look at its prime decomposition, and if you're divisible by a prime power, you're zero, and otherwise it just counts in your decomposition how many primes divide into this. So this is an extension on a partially ordered set. So that's on the divisor lattice, what I'm going to define. So this is the bottom element of this poset, so let me just denote this by zero hat. So we're going to define Mobius function inductively. So on the trivial interval measured from 0 to 0 is 1. And then from 0 to any element x, we're just going to sum up Mobius values below and take the negative. So here, values y less than x greater or equal to the bottom element. So I'm going to start indicating Mobius values. So here we have plus 1, because we're just taking the Mobius value from empty bottom element to itself. Here we just look at everything below, take the negative. So the negative of positive 1, all these. For this element, we add up everything below and take the negative. So I have negative 3 plus 1 is negative 2. The negative of that is positive 2. Let's see, this is going to be, we have a negative 1 and negative 1 and positive 1. This becomes positive 1, positive 1, positive 1. Oops. And finally, the top, I have to add all these Mobius values and take the negative. So I have 2, 3, 4, 5, and 1 is 6, minus 4 is 2. The negative of that is negative 2. Okay, so this is the Mobius values. So now we can actually write down the characteristic polynomial in this case. So for this arrangement, it's going to be 1 times this three-dimensional space, t to the third. And then we have negative 4 times, each of these were two-dimensional spaces, t squared, plus 2, 3, 4, 5, t minus 2. So this is the characteristic polynomial. So there are some combinatorial interpretations of this. So one particular class of hyperplane arrangements that Bloss and Sagan studied was the braid arrangement, the subarrangements of the braid arrangement. And they could actually give an interpretation of the characteristic polynomial, get at these coefficients. There's a way in terms of counting certain lattice points. Athanasiadis has a mod Q method. And this holds for hyperplane arrangements where the defining coefficients in the equations have rational coefficients. And then with Ehrenborg, we have a valuations approach. And since this is easy to remember, let me actually just go through and do it in this example. So what we're going to be doing is, the interpretation is that the characteristic polynomial actually measures the complement of the arrangement. So if you think about, so which points which are not on the arrangement, the space that's not on the arrangement. So if you think about this whole arrangement lives in three-dimensional space, so that has measure t cubed. So here's the t cubed. And then we want to remove all points that are on the arrangement. So I have to remove each of these four two-dimensional hyperplanes of points. So that's going to be minus 4t squared. However, when we did this, we removed too much. If you think about this line of points was removed 1, 2, 3 times. So we have to add back in 2 times its measure, which is t. Same with each of these three lines intersecting the horizontal hyperplane. They've been each subtracted 1 too many times. So there's 3 more of those. So that's where this plus 5t is taking in consideration. And finally, the negative 2, the origin has been added and subtracted lots of times. So if you carefully count, you actually see the correction that it should be minus 2. So that's the valuation approach. Okay. All right, so the next thing we want to take a look at is actually we want to get a spherical decomposition associated with an arrangement. So what we're going to do is take a sphere and we're going to intersect it with the arrangement and start looking at the various face incidences. So if we do that in this particular case, we get something like this. I guess something you see on the Jersey Shore. So this looks like a beach ball. So this is a decomposition of a two-dimensional sphere. And what we want to keep track of is different face incidences. And that's going to be taken care of with the flag F vector. So start doing this. So I'm going to be keeping track of different flags of faces in this. So tell you what this all means in a moment. So here, F empty is just counting the number of empty faces in this decomposition. So there's one. There's always one of nothing. F zero is going to count the number of zero-dimensional points in this. So we have 6 vertices around the equator, and then we have a north and a south pole. So that's going to be 8. F one is going to count the number of edges, segments in this. So again, there's 6 on the top, 6 on the bottom, and then we have 6 segments going around the equator. So that's going to be 18. Let's see, F2, number of 2 faces. So again, 6 on the top, 6 on the bottom is 12. So right at this point, this is called the F vector, the face vector. So we haven't really kept track of any sort of incidences yet, but now we actually are. So, for example, F01 is going to keep track of the number of zero-dimensional pairs of a zero-dimensional, one-dimensional face which are incident with each other. So, for example, if you look at the North Pole, that vertex is incident with six possible edges, same with the South. And then along the equator, each of these six vertices is incident with four edges. So we have, let's say, two vertices that are incident with six edges. And then we have six vertices, which are each incident with four. So we end up getting 36. F02, similarly, is going to count vertex two-dimensional face pairs. And again, we have the same sort of incident structure. If you give me a vertex on the North Pole, that's incident with six two-dimensional faces. So it's the same sort of count. So you get 36. Let's see, F12, what this is counting, given an edge, how many two-dimensional faces are incident with it? So it's always two. You give me any edge, there's always two faces that you could be incident with, like here, 12. So it's just going to be 2 times the number of edges. So 2 times F1, or again, 36. And finally, F012 actually counts the number of full flags. So I've heard in the seminar, people say flags. For me, flags is all this information, but this is the full flag. So number of vertex edge two-dimensional face triples where everyone is incident with each other. So we can actually recycle F01. So once you're given a vertex and an edge pair, there are two-dimensional faces you can select to be incident. So it's going to be 36 times 2, or 72. So this is the flag F vector. So next thing we want to do is we want to massage this data a little bit with something called the flag H vector. So this is a certain alternating sum of these F numbers. And so let's start computing this. So for example, so H empty is the same as F empty, so that's 1. H0 is going to be F0 minus F empty, so 8 minus 1 is 7. In fact, all these on the regular face vector, F vector, just going to be subtracting 1 off of these values. Okay, so the first non-trivial one is H01. So that's going to be F01, 36, minus F0, minus F1. So it's going to be 36 minus 26 is 10, plus 1 is 11. And if you go through and compute the other three values, you end up getting, miraculously, 17, 7, and 1. So notice that we get something that's symmetric. And that actually follows, this is a result of Richard Stanley's, that this complex has the property of being shellable, that there's a nice way that we can build this complex one maximal face at a time. So it comes out of this. But anyway, this is the flag H vector. Is this okay? All right. So, yeah. Oh, no, it's not equivalent. No, this is a consequence of shellability. Yeah. Okay, so the next thing I want to do is we want to encode these subsets. And this is where the non-commutativity comes in. So I want to encode the empty set. So you think of the empty set as means that we are not selecting a 0, 1, or 2-dimensional face. So we're going to encode that with a word of length 3 with AAA. So A stands for absent. So 0, 1, and 2 are absent from the empty set. For the set consisting of 0, 0 is in, and 1 and 2 are absent. So think of B standing for be there. And this is really the way we think about this. And then keep on going this way. Set consisting of, let's see, this was 0, 1. This could be ABA, AAB. Maybe I should do this. 0, 1, BBA, BAB. ABB, and then finally, 0, 1, 2 is all Bs. So this is just a formal way to keep track of the subsets. That's all this is. Non-commutative, don't let things commute. So now we're actually ready to define the AB index. So this is the AB index of a graded poset. So psi of P is we're going to use as coefficients the flag gauge values. And those are going to be coefficients on the monomials that are encoding these subsets. So for example, the example that we're looking at, let's call this something, the intersection lattice associated with this. Let's call this T. So let's look, this is the lattice of whatever, the subdivision. So if we look at this example, we end up getting 1 AAA, whatever, 7 BAA, 17 ABA, 11 AAB, 11 BBA, 17 BAB, 7 ABB, and finally 1 BBB. So that's the AB index. Okay, now Jonathan Fine, who comes up with ideas. Oop, this is not quite right. You're supposed to correct me. 1 BBB. So Jonathan Fine conjectured that, he has lots of conjectures, that but he wants other people to prove them or disprove them for himself. And probably I shouldn't have said that because now it's on tape. That let's make a change of variable. So let's consider the following two. Variables. So these are non-commutative. So C is A plus B, D is AB plus BA. So if you consider A and B to be degree one, C is a degree one variable and D is degree two. And then the theorem actually is, so this is due to Bayer and Clapper, and also in the case of face lattices of polytopes, and Stanley, more generally for Eulerian posets, that the face lattice of a polytope, and more generally for Eulerian posets, which I haven't defined yet, the AB index can be written. Excuse me?
What's the name?
Eulerian?
What?
Eulerian? Eulerian? Like Euler.
Okay.
So I haven't defined that yet, so I'm being very bad.
I wanted to know what it was.
Oh, yes, Eulerian. Yes, so yes. Can be written in terms of C and D. So let's actually do this. So remember, we're in the situation where it's non-commutative. So one thing we can do is we can peel off a c cubed. Now think of that, c cubed is a plus b cubed. So when you expand that, we're peeling off one off of each of these coefficients. So I don't know if you want me to cross them out or remember in your head.
So it will be a non-commutative polynomial on c
and d, is that right? The a b can be written in terms of c and d. Yeah, a non-commutative polynomial. Thank you. You're being very precise. I'm being not very precise. Yeah, so exactly. So it's non-commutative polynomial. So yeah.
What you've written is invariant under switching A and B, but I assume you're going to prove something a little more substantial.
Oh, of course. Because, you know, right now it just feels like, why would this be helpful, right? I mean, that's just everyone's feeling, I think, when this first was being developed was, is this going to do anything? You know, who knows? So, but let's just... Just put on your seatbelt, let's go.
It's like we're... I'm not sure that just being symmetric with A and B is enough for this.
Okay. So you know, continuing with this, so we peel off one off of all these coefficients. So in particular, here we're left with 6 BAA, and maybe I'll cross off. I'm being bad now. So I'll just cross off. So notice this can be realized as D times C, part of the D times C. And in fact, that's going to pull 6 off of this coefficient, et cetera. You can see Let's see, this is still 10, 10, this goes away. And then we're actually left with the four remaining terms becomes 10 CD. So this is the CD index in this case. So you start asking, okay, why is this, you know, do anything? Well, it's actually a result due to, so this is called the CD index. This is all polytopes. This exists for. Oh, so actually, I didn't define Eulerian. So, what is Eulerian? So you know, we formed a partially ordered set. An Eulerian partially ordered set is one if, where you look in any subinterval and compute the Möbius function, you always get negative one to the length of the interval. And another, an equivalent formulation is that Euler-Poincaré holds in every interval. Or another equivalent formulation, if you don't like those two, is that if you look in every subinterval, the number of even-ranked elements is equal to the number of odd-ranked elements. So those are all equivalent statements of being Eulerian. So why is this important? Well, one thing, notice that we started with 8 pieces of information. Because of shellability, this got cut down into 2 by a factor of 2 into 4 pieces of information. And now we have 3 coefficients to keep track of. And notice that we can go backwards, that we can replace C with A plus B, any occurrence of D with AB plus BA. We can recapture the flag H vector entries. And actually, we can again go backwards to obtain the flag F vector, because this is invertible by Möbius inversion theorem, if that FS can actually be written as sum of the H's. So what's happening is that if you can find some kind of inequality involving the CD index, because when you make the change of variable into the flag H vector entries, that this is a non-negative linear combination. And again, you can take non-negative linear combinations of the flag H entries to get the flag F. This is very, very powerful already. And so one thing that's I didn't mention was that, let's see, this is due to Bayer and Billera. So before all the CD index stuff, they determined all the linear relations that hold among the flag F vector entries. And these are called the generalized N Somerville relations. So one such example is Euler-Poincaré relation. And so Bayer with Clapper actually showed that the generalized N Somerville relations are actually equivalent to the CD index. So in other words, the CD index is removing all linear relations that hold among the flag F vector. So this is really giving a very natural basis for the flag F vector space. So this is, you know, sort of the beginning of everything. CD index. Good question. Let's see. If you have the same, well, if you have a hyperplane arrangement, there's actually an associated, if they have the same CD index. I mean, given a hyperplane arrangement, if they had the same CD index, that's equivalent to you have two polytopes that have the same CD index. Because if you take a normal to each of these hyperplanes, that's, you take the Minkowski sum of the normals, and that's going to generate your zonotope. I don't know if I know anything, actually. I mean, this is actually an open question to find a nice combinatorial interpretation for the coefficients. There is a combinatorial interpretation in the case of N simplex and somewhat the N cube, but in general, there's nothing known. I mean, this is really open. We'll see that there's going to be a relation. Yeah, we can continue. Okay, so what I want to do next is, let's see, I did this. What I want to do is start talking about, let's get at this information in a faster way. Because this is a lot of work, you know, writing down a flag F vector, flag H vector, compute the U's, and go to the CD index. So there must be a faster way to do this. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to look at the dual picture of this decomposition of the sphere. So we're going to look at T-dual. And as I was mentioning, of course, I just erased this, is that, go to this picture. If we put a vertex in each of these faces and then connect a vertex if there is an edge between the, connect two vertices if there's an edge between those two faces, this is the dual picture. You're actually going to get the prism of the hexagon. You can see the hexagon on the top, hexagon on the bottom, and you get the prism. So let's actually look at T star. So here is going to be the face lattice of prism of the hexagon. So how do we do this? Well, so I'm not going to draw everything because I'll be here all day. So first I want to keep track of various hexagonal faces or things that are combinatorial that way that occur. So when you form the hexagon, the prism of the hexagon, first you have a hexagon and then you're lifting it up to form the prism. So you actually have two hexagons, the bottom facet and the top one. So the face lattice is basically this. And then when you're forming the prism, notice that this vertex, when you lift it, there's an associated edge, becomes a face of one dimensional higher. This edge sweeps out and forms a two face. So we actually have another copy of this one level up. Somebody say great? Ah, okay. And then, of course, we have the whole, excuse me? Can't hear. Okay. And then we have to start connecting things. So this is the whole polytope. Here we have a vertex that's going to be incident with the edge that it created. So you have to start connecting things that correspond. So that would be this, this, et cetera. And I'm not going to sketch all this in because it's crazy, but you get the idea. Okay. And then finally, at the bottom of this poset, we have the empty face. Okay. So this is a messy poset. And if you think about it, the two hexagons. Oh, I forgot totally. Oh, bad. I'm sorry. You're right. Thank you for keeping me honest. Yeah, so you're right. Okay. It's messier than even I was thinking about. Okay, so you have this thing. And we start thinking about chains in this poset. Various chains passing through different levels. This corresponds in the dual picture of actually looking at flags of faces here. So we've actually looked at the flag F vector, flag H vector of this whole thing. In fact, the CD index, it's because it's dual, you just read everything backwards. So you end up getting CQ plus 6 CD plus 10 DC. So the next thing is you say, well, this is a mess. It shouldn't be this. There should be an easier way to look at this, because we have the intersection lattice sitting around. So let me draw a picture of the intersection lattice, try to get at the same level. So again, well, let me think at the same level. So this is the intersection lattice. Well, I'm going to add an extra element because right now this has this is of rank 1, 2, 3, 4, and this lattice is only of rank 3. So I'm going to add an artificial bottom element to this. And let's actually define a map between these two. So this is going to go from T dual to L union bottom element. So I'm going to map the bottom of the dual to this new minimal element. And then what I want to do is then any face here, I'm going to map to its affine hull. And why this is a nice map is the fact that it's order preserving and also rank preserving. So this is helpful. So then there's a theorem due to Bayer and Sturmfels, which says that if you have a chain in this poset, how we can lift it back, what is this inverse image in this poset? What's the coronality of it? So again, this is for,
how many chains map to the chain?
If you give me a chain here, how many chains map into here? Yep. So if you have a central arrangement, H, and you have a chain going from x naught, x1, up to xk in the intersection lattice with this extra bottom element in, then it turns out the inverse image of this chain is going to be a product of some things. So again, I have to define this. So we call this the Zaslavsky invariant after Tom Zaslavsky. Oh, I forgot to do something way at the beginning. Oh, I'm so sorry. I just remembered. I did the characteristic polynomial. I never plugged in any particular value on it. So, okay, I was bad. All right, I goes from 1 to k minus 1, where if you have a graded poset, this Zaslavsky invariant is, okay, so we have to compute a Möbius function. And then we have to have negative 1 to negative 1 to the rank. I'm losing it. It's to the rank, because it should be, you have to put in negative 1 to t. OK, so what does this mean?
What does it mean to top? What is the parentheses?
OK, this means that you have a chain. We're going to look at its inverse image under the Z map. Look at the coronality of the inverse image. How many chains map into it? This means a mess. And you should feel like it's a mess. This was the whole point of this, is that what is this telling you? In every subinterval here, you have to compute a Möbius function. You have to, because each of these subintervals are a graded poset in its own right, you have to compute the Möbius function and negative 1 to the rank. And it's just a mess, 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 mess. But what this is telling you is that theoretically, with a lot of work, you can compute using the intersection lattice the flag vector of your decomposition of the sphere. So you should.
The question was what the square brackets mean.
Yeah, what is that? It's the pair.
Here? Oh, this is the I to I plus 1.
What do you mean by that?
Oh, this is like you have a chain in this poset, so you have your intersection lattice with the extra bottom element, and you have some chain of elements here. So you start here as your first. Maybe you pick one out here as your second one. Here's your third, whatever. And here's the top. So here's some chain of elements. And now what it's saying is that this interval here, for example here, is the subposet where everything in here is greater or equal to x1, less than or equal to x2. It's an interval in the poset. That's all that is. OK, so you should feel like this is a mess, and it is. But we have a map to help us save the day, and it's the omega map. And we chose omega because it's the last map you'll ever need. So let's let omega. We did. People think this is that we're joking, but it's serious. OK, omega. So what this is going to do is it's going to map from the algebra ZAB to ZCD. And what it's going to do is whenever it sees a word that has an AB, so first you replace all ABs with 2D, and then the remaining A's and B's we're going to replace with C's. So let me give you an example of the omega map. So if we have omega of A, B, B, A, B, A, something like that, doesn't matter. What is this? So first we look for A, B's. So this becomes 2 times D. And then all remaining letters are going to be a C. So this is a C, this is a C, this is a C. So we end up getting 4, remember, noncommutative, D, C, C, D, C. So this is the omega map. Now I can
omega ring homomorphism? Well, okay.
No, never mind. Look at AB.
Yeah, but yeah, because
AB goes to 2D.
Right.
Whereas
it's
just a map. It's just so you have to take care of the ABs first. And then anything else that's left becomes a C. So now we can state the theorem. So this is, again, just hyperplane arrangements. So this is theorem. So this is with Billera and Ehrenborg, is that in this situation, what we're going to do is we can actually get the intersection lattice. So okay, H is a central arrangement. Then turns out the CD index of T is going to be, so we have to take, I should say, with intersection lattice L. So we're going to look at the AB index of the intersection lattice, pre-multiply it by A, apply the omega map, and then take the dual, read everything backwards. And that's all you have to do. So it's much, much easier. So this business with the A, this is actually coming from the fact this pre-multiplying is that we're adding this extra zero on the bottom of the poset. So this is not, you know, any sort of magic. It's coming out of that. So let's actually look at this example. Maybe I'll keep this up here for now. Well, so let's actually compute this AB index real fast for this poset. Bless you. So now I'm using ranks. So we have no chains going through none of the ranks. We have 4 chains that just hit rank 1, 4 that hit rank 2, and then 1 hitting rank 1 and 2. We have 4, 5, 6. Oh, I did this right. Something's not right. That's okay. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Let me compute the H, flag H. So 9 minus 8 is 1 plus 1 is 2. So here, the AB index is going to be 1AA, 3BA, 3AB, 2BB. And so now, what this says is that so this omega map, so we're going to pre-multiply everything by A. So we have AAA, 3ABA, 3AAB, 2ABB. So again, you look for the ABs first. So we end up getting CQ plus 3 times 2DC plus 3C times 2D plus 2 times 2D times C. We have to still dual everything. So you end up getting CQ plus 6DC plus 4DC is 10DC. And then over here we have a 6CD. And then dueling everything is just read everything backwards. C cubed plus 10CD plus 6DC. And if you look back in your notes or you rewind the videotape, this is what we got before. So it's really easy.
Sorry, I've lost it because I don't remember what capital C was. So you've got a central arrangement that gives you two posets, one for the...
The sphere, you take the arrangement, intersect it with the sphere. Let's look at what the A, the CD index of this decomposition is.
Of one out of the AB index of the other?
Yes.
Yeah, right.
You get the CD index of the spherical decomposition from the AB index. And this is so much easier.
Right.
So, okay, so where's this? Oh, it's a lot of work. T was when you look at... okay, this picture I had here, flip it upside down. So this is actually the face poset when you flip it upside down of the dual of this zonotope, the prism of the hexagon. So that's all that is. And if you want to know this CD index, it's this without the dual. Move the dual to the other side. That's all that is. Okay, let me say something about the proof ingredients. Yeah, this is real. Right now, we're doing real. So one is that we need a coproduct, delta. And so delta on a word in A and B. So let's say U is some word in A and B of length N. So all we do is you write down the word and replace the ith letter with a tensor sign. So this is just a formal expression. So under this map, delta of A, you replace the A with a tensor sign. That goes to 1 tensor 1, which is the same as delta B. So C, delta of C, so this is linear. So C is A plus B, so this goes to 2 times 1 tensor 1. And then delta of D, so that's delta of AB plus BA. This is, this satisfies the product rule. So this is going to be A times delta of B, so that's A tensor 1, plus delta of A times B is going to be 1 tensor B, plus B times delta of A, B tensor 1, plus... delta of B times A, 1 tensor B, A. And when you add these guys up, you get C tensor 1 plus 1 tensor C. So this was sort of the amazing thing that Richard Ehrenborg and I realized was the fact that this coproduct, it's when you restrict it to CD words, you're still getting something in CD land. So the second ingredient that we need is huh?
Can you find the primitive there?
Oh, I don't know. Don't ask me hard questions right now. Okay. No, I don't know. I don't know. I mean, this is where it's related with Hopf algebras. Okay. Second thing that we need is Bayer-Sturmfels result. And the third thing that we actually need is that the AB index, and it turns out the CD index is a coalgebra homomorphism. Coalgebra homomorphism. A homomorphism with respect to this delta. So one way to think about a consequence of that, if I still have Bayer-Sturmfels up here, is that this is a big product. So we're looking over chains, we're breaking up a poset into pieces, and we have a product occurring. And you should think of each of these products, there's a tensor sign sitting in there. And what it's actually saying is that you can actually realize an expression as a coproduct applied to the AB index of the entire poset that you're considering. So it's telling you that there is a chance that you can actually find a nice expression for whatever it is. So, you know, this was a mess, but all of a sudden you can realize this as a very nice expression. So at least this gives you some small idea about where things are coming from. Okay, so. Oh, the coalgebra is because it's breaking things up. That's the whole point of these chains. You're breaking up your poset into pieces. So
Right,
and there are people who they love to think about the dual, and that's harder in some. I think we think it's harder. I think looking at quasi-symmetric functions stuff, I think that's much harder. The peak algebra, I think it's much harder. This is, to me, this is so much easier. It's very hands-on. Okay, let's move off the sphere, because that's what you've been waiting for. Huh? Okay. So let me first state, so in the case that when we have, so what we want to look at is eventually the n-dimensional torus, but if we have a regular CW complex, so we're really changing gears, whose geometric realization is a compact, n-dimensional manifold M. So now we're in a situation, for example, if you have a nice decomposition of the torus, this is an example of this, and let's let P be the face poset, bless you, of omega, then we actually almost have a CD index. So the thing is, in this situation, when you have if you have a regular decomposition of the sphere, what you have is that the associated face poset is Eulerian. So the thing is that in this case, we won't necessarily have Eulerian. All the intervals will be Eulerian except for the entire poset. So because of that, we almost have a CD index. And what it looks like is if you look at the Euler characteristic of the manifold, this is going to be the coefficient on a plus minus b to the m plus 1. Then we have Euler characteristic of the manifold over 2. This is c to the m plus 1. And then we get a polynomial that's homogeneous. CD polynomial, and C to the n plus 1 does not occur in it. So, for example, if you're looking at the torus, the Euler characteristic is 0. So, what this theorem is saying, there is hope. So let's see. So for example, when n is odd here, this is going to be even. So this a minus b to an even power actually can be written in terms of c and d. It's c squared minus 2d. So we actually do have a CD index. I haven't said anything about the non-negativity of the coefficients or anything, but for the torus, what this is saying is that let's just put T sub T. So you have your face poset in the background that this is going to look like, A minus B to the M plus 1 plus this other CD polynomial at the end. So what this is saying, we have something almost like a CD index. Yeah, so this goes away. Yeah, so, yep. And it's not, then you just have, because this is going to be the clean C power and then everything else. In fact, you always have that with the decomposition of the sphere. You always have C, 1 times C to a power, and then the rest.
What's
phi? What's phi? It's just, we don't know. That's an excellent question. That's one of my open questions at the end. What is it? It's a CD polynomial.
It's the same thing as there.
What are you asking about?
It's a CD polynomial.
It's a CD polynomial, homogeneous of degree n plus 1. That's all we know.
Would you remind us what psi of p is?
Psi of p is the AB index or the CD index. When you're lucky, it's the CD index. This is the AB index of the face poset of, you have your, and this probably should be of m. No, omega is okay. No, because this is the decomposition. This is the manifold. This is the decomposition. Okay.
Do you happen to know what you'd get if you took the triangulation of real projective space?
I have no idea. That's an excellent question. We haven't even gotten to projective space. What is it?
In particular, RP2.
RP2.
The projective plane.
Okay. We need to work on it. That's all I can say.
The non-orientability might sort of
make this interesting. Huh. Okay. Okay. I'd be interested in hearing more about this. Okay. So let's actually look at a toric arrangement. Has to be regular. We need regular.
Regular.
We need regular. It's not regular.
Regular.
Yeah, regular.
No, but he's an RP2.
It's RP2.
Regular.
Yeah, you need regular. We need. I'm sorry. It's regular.
Yes.
Good. So we need regular, otherwise forget it. Okay, so let's look at a toric arrangement. So let's look at, so I'm drawing this on the square. So y is equal to x, y is a third, y is two-thirds, x is a third, x is two-thirds. So this is a toric arrangement. And,
very confusing.
Did you call it something else, because toric arrangement.
Well, some people call them toric arrangements. Some people call them toroidal arrangements. You like toroidal? How about a what? Arrangement of the torus. Sure. Okay, let's see. So let's start labeling these things. I'm going to need this, so I just don't want to make mistakes. A prime, B, B prime. So here's an arrangement of the torus. So again, we have an associated intersection poset, so it's not a lattice anymore. So we have these five lines. So here is C, here's AB, B prime, A prime. And so notice that here, AB and C, I haven't drawn this so great, intersect in a point. And same thing with A prime, B prime, and C. These intersect in a point. And then what do we have? A prime and B intersect in a point. And then what's left? B prime and A intersect in a point. And then we're going to be a little bit bad. I know these don't intersect, but we're just going to put on an artificial top element because we like our posets to have a bottom, natural bottom, and a top element. So you can start asking, what about the characteristic polynomial of this? And rather than going through the whole computation, I'll just write it down. So we're going to get t squared minus 5t and plus 6 here. And it turns out it's a theorem. So actually, I didn't mention that starting over here, this is actually with Ehrenborg and Slone. So theorem is that the characteristic polynomial in this toric case is given by evaluation of the complement of the arrangement in the way that we spoke about this before. Something else I forgot to do when I was looking at the real case was, if you go back to that example, if you plug negative 1 into the characteristic polynomial up to a sign, you have to correct the sign, you're going to get the number of regions that this splits up. So if you think about that first hyperplane arrangement, we had 6 regions on top, 6 on the bottom, so you'll get 12. So the question is, what is the analog in this situation? And if you think about it, plugging -1 into the characteristic polynomial, so we have an n-dimensional open bowl, -1 to the n is the Euler characteristic. So the right thing here should be putting in 0, the Euler characteristic of the torus. And that's also part of this, is that when you have the right sign and plugging in t is equal to 0, you get the number of regions in the arrangement, toric arrangement, toroidal arrangement of the torus, whatever. So for example here, if I plug in 0, we get 6. And if you do the count, we really do get 6 regions. There's 4, 5, wraps around here, wraps down to here. That's probably it. And then 6, this wraps over here. OK, so yes, Mark.
And up to the top.
Oh, I'm sorry. 6, thank you. OK, so then the next natural question is, OK, you have this intersection poset. What if you start looking at the flag vector of this, you know, vertex, edge, face, triples, all this information? Can we actually do this? And the answer is yes. So in this whole setting, it turns out that if you want to find the corresponding toric decomposition, the AB index, well, what do we know? So we have this A minus B to the M plus 1, plus the omega map occurs. We have a pre-multiply of by A. What else? We have the AB index of our poset. However, for technical reasons, we have a map, about what's called H. H stands for hack off. So you should hack off the last letter from each of the monomials. You need something to remember this. I'm not using my notes, and then I messed up at the beginning. So OK. But anyway, OK, it's true. It really is. And then there's a B on the end. And we apply omega. We take a half and dual. But it works. OK? And then how do we do this? So proof ingredients again. Wow, it works. Can't believe it. We were shocked. We were so shocked. It wasn't funny. So again, we have this co-product. Again, we have to have the Z-map, toric version of that. We have a toric version of Bayer Sturmfels, and I think I lost Bayer and Sturmfels somewhere. But so we had this whole product, and you know, with these subintervals, and then there's actually a new toric invariant you have to compute on the last step to account for things, and then it all works. So let me actually say something about current things that we're working on. So I should say we as in royal we, I guess. So let's see. So some current work is, so we did a little bit of a cheat when we were decomposing the torus with these hyperplane arrangements. So this was really a zonotopal decomposition of this manifold. So you can start asking, you know, what is the right analog of a regular decomposition, subdivision, whatever, so that it is polytopal in some sense. And also a related question is actually to classify flag vectors in this situation. Let's see, something else. So Calai has a convolution for, if you have an inequality for a m-dimensional and n-dimensional polytope, that you can find a new inequality for an m plus n plus 1 dimensional polytope. So the question is that, should I raise this? Is that, is there a toric version of the Kalai convolution? Another thing is that Ehrenborg has a lifting technique. So if you know something about an inequality for CDs, some CD coefficients, let me just represent that as H, and let's say you know you have some expression and it's non-negative, if you pre-multiply this by D, post-multiply by D, put any CD word at the front and back, they don't have to be the same, this gives you a new inequality. So actually he's used this to get new inequalities, so inequalities for flag vectors of polytopes of dimension 6 and up. We actually don't know really anything in dimension 4 and up. So the question is whether you can actually find a toric version of this. So technique. So I was also asked about this phi that occurs. What can we say about this? Is this non-negative? You know, on what cases is it non-negative? Can we find something that bounds it below? For example, for the CD index of a polytope and more generally of a Gornstein star poset, it's known that the CD index, the coefficients are minimized by the CD index of the n-dimensional simplex with Boolean algebra. So is there a statement like that? And another thing is actually, Goreski and McPherson have this wonderful theory of hyperplane arrangements. When you complexify them and you look at the complement of the space, and you can actually talk about the homology groups using the intersection lattice. So is there a toric version of this? And actually the answer is yes, this is known. So this is due to Procesi and DiConcini, is it D-I? D-E, sorry. DiConcini have this. That's all I have to say for today. Thank you very much.